Give God a big hand clap of praise. We hope that you were able to pick up a palm branch on your way into this service. And if you haven't received yours yet, please run down right now. This is your chance to grab a beautiful palm branch here at the altar and use this palm branch throughout our worship experience today. I'm excited to share with you a few announcements as we begin this service. Messiah was a huge success this week, and we saw this entire floor filled with members of our community. Our members of Lighthouse were in the minority, but almost every face was from our city. Can we thank our community for showing up to support Messiah Forever? And we're excited for two more showings this week. We want to encourage our congregation, our LC family, to attend both performances on Thursday and Friday at 7:30 p.m. If you've bought a ticket, you can use that for both performances. And today we want to encourage you to purchase more tickets for your friends and family. They are on sale, so you can get them for $8. And if you buy 10 or more, everybody say, I get two for free. So please invite your neighbors, invite your friends. You don't want to miss Messiah Forever. Our LC Kids Community Easter Egg Hunt is this Saturday. Can we give our students a big round of applause? We will begin at 10 a.m. and we are going to have an egg hunt with over 3,000 Easter eggs. Thank you, Lighthouse, for donating these Easter eggs and candies. We love the children of our community. There's going to be a petting zoo from the Gove Family Farm. There's going to be photos with the Easter Bunny. But more importantly, we're going to talk to those children about Jesus Christ and how he paid the price for their sins so that one day they could know him and have salvation. Lastly, tonight, everyone say Next Gen. We are excited for Next Gen's Bible study here at Lighthouse at 5 p.m., a new series with our youth pastors called The Dreamer. Let's give our Next Gen group a big round of applause. We love them. We're excited for growth in our youth department. And now all over this place, if you'll stand with me as we prepare our hearts for worship today. It is Palm Sunday. It is the day that we pause and reflect that moment thousands of years ago when Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. He was riding not on a noble steed, not with a crown on his head, but he sat on top of a donkey. However, this moment was a fulfillment of prophecy. And everyone who witnessed this occurrence knew that seeing him on that donkey walk into Jerusalem was a fulfillment and meant the Messiah had come. So they lined the streets and they waved palm branches in the air. And what did they shout? Hosanna. Today on Palm Sunday, we join our voices with those from 2,000 years ago, and we declare that the Messiah has come, and he is here today. We invite you to wave your palm branches as we sing Hosanna Forever.
every voice, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. The Lamb. Come on, say it again. You are holy. Come on, put him on his throne.
Holy.
Are you Lord God?
Are you Lord God?
Almighty. We say, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You're holy. Come on and lift him up today and lift him up.
Are you Lord?
Almighty. We say, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
You are holy. Why don't you take your hands and clap them again? That sounded great this morning. Let's clap our hands to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. If you know his name, why don't you just shout it in this place? If you know the healer's name, why don't you shout his name in this place? If you know the one that provides, why don't you shout his name in this place? If you know who the King is today, why don't you shout his name in this room? All the people in this house, clap your hands unto God and shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph, for he has triumphed in this place. Praise God. Amen. If you'll continue to stand, it is a joy to welcome you here today for this very special Sunday known all over the world as Palm Sunday. This is the day where Jesus would have made the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, leading up to Passover, as he was giving himself up as the perfect lamb. And today we welcome his presence in this room. The same one who rode on the donkey and who eventually took the cross on his shoulders and bled and died and rose on the third day, he is alive today, and there is a church that serves him and welcomes him into their midst. And even on this Sunday morning at Lighthouse Church, I wonder if there's a few people who could just go a little extra mile today welcoming your King. Why don't you take the palm branch and just wave it to the Lord and say, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Hosanna to the Lord of Lords. Praise God. We welcome him here today. When Jesus rode on the donkey, he was fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, found in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is come to you. Righteous, having salvation, is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, and the foal of a donkey, Zechariah 9:9. When Jesus came, he came and he fulfilled every prophecy that was spoken about him. And this occurrence of Jesus coming in to Jerusalem can be found in all four Gospels. And this morning, we want to just welcome you to Palm Sunday at Lighthouse. Are you glad to be here today? We're going to have such a great day. As you continue to stand, let's go before the Lord with our prayer and supplication. And we believe as we go to him, we can ask for anything, and he hears us today. We can come boldly before the throne, and our Father hears us. And this morning, I just want to encourage you to join me in prayer. If you're here today, you can pray. You can open your mouth and speak his name. And this morning, why don't you just do that right now by lifting your hands and stretching them upward to God. And just let him know you are here for him. Say, Father, I need you today. Father, I come with my arms stretched up like a little child does to his dad. I put my hands upward and say, Lord, I need you today. I need your strength today. I need all the gifts that you have for me today. I need your joy. I need your peace. I need your love that's available for me. God, I need what you have. I want to be in your presence today. I've come to worship you. I've come to exalt you. I've come to praise you. I've come to lift up your name in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It is a joy to welcome all of you here today for this very special Palm Sunday. And in particular, we are so blessed and we are so honored to have with us the ministry of the Hanscoms, Brother and Sister Hanscoms. And they are here to my left, and we just want them to know they are welcome back home. Let's give them a good Lighthouse Church welcome this morning, everybody. We are so glad that they are with us today. And I'm just looking forward to the ministry of Brother and Sister Hanscom. Both of these wonderful people are no strangers to this church. And I hope my father will add to what I'm saying and give you a little more information than what I'm sharing now. But years ago, they became dear friends of my parents, and they became wonderful friends of this church. And they have blessed this church for many, many years with their ministry. Their books have always been in our bookstore, and they just come today with so much experience, so much joy sharing what God has done over the years of their ministries. And I believe they were in Pakistan for almost 18 years, if I'm not mistaken, and they saw miracle after miracle, and it's just amazing to see what God has done. And they're here today, and I'm looking forward to hearing the ministry of Brother Hanscom. Could we hear a big hand for them one more time? God bless them in Jesus' name. This past Friday evening was our first showing of Messiah, and it was an absolute success. And we want to say to all of our cast, what a fantastic job you did with the very first performance with Messiah. It was just phenomenal, and this place was full of visitors from our community, and we were so blessed to welcome all of our community to our campus this past Friday evening. This coming Thursday and Friday night, we are looking forward to the showings of Messiah at 7:30, and today I want to encourage you to make sure you make plans to be here for those showings. On Friday night, we will be partaking in the Lord's Supper as Jesus is with his disciples and they're partaking of the Lord's Supper. We will do so as an audience, and we will partake with the Lord. That would be on Good Friday. That is the day that Jesus would have taken the cross and would have died on the cross. So I do hope that you will plan to be with us both Thursday and Friday. Why not come both nights? It's going to be incredible. Let's make this a wonderful Easter, everybody. And then I want to give a personal invitation to everyone here to be with us for Easter Sunday morning. We're going to have such a wonderful day as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Are you glad he's alive this morning? Are you glad you serve a God that's alive today? Amen. I know you just sat down, but why don't you stand back up? We're going to ask our ushers to make themselves ready as we worship the Lord in our giving today. And we're going to get right into the word. I'm looking forward to the ministry again of our dear friends. Just going to be a dynamic day. How many of you are expecting awesome things today? How many of you believe God wants to do awesome things in this building today? Amen. I believe he does. Let's just pray that God will have his way. Let's pray that from the very beginning to the very end, that God would just have his way. We're believing for everyone watching online, all of our friends, all of our elders, anyone who is watching online who may be sick, recovering from surgery. We bless you and we declare you healed in Jesus' name. And we pray the same presence of God that we feel in this room today, you will feel at your home in Jesus' name. Could we give our online family a huge hand, everybody? Let them know we love them today. God bless you. Let's go before the Lord in prayer for this offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for bringing us to this place as we celebrate you, your presence. You are the King of this house. We pray your special blessing upon this offering. We pray, God, that everything that is given will be blessed in Jesus' name. We bless you in advance for the miracles that are going to take place today. We bless you in advance for the gifts of salvation that will be given today in Jesus' name. We will not fail to give you all of our praise. We will not fail to give you all of our worship, all of our energy. You have our full attention. And everybody shout out in Jesus' name. God bless you. Let's give in Jesus' name.
Beauty for our shame. I shed, took shame to glory. can turn it all around. Oh, my good. I felt a rush of angels all over this place when you were singing that song. How many feels the presence of the Lord in this place right now? Oh, my God. Have mercy. Well, what a joy it is to be able to gather together and then have in our service today some of the greatest people in all of the earth. Brother and Sister Hanscom, we're welcoming you along with Pastor Joel and Sister Shanae back to Milford, Delaware. I know you've already done it. Let's give them another good Milford, Delaware welcome, everybody. Come on up here. It is a joy that they have come, and we've been trying to make this work for quite a while. I remember years ago in 1985, my wife and I, along with Sister Shreve, she was 14 years old at that time, we went to the land of Pakistan. And I'm telling you what, we had revival there. This godly man and woman started those works all across that country. And God has blessed since then, since those years. There's literal thousands of people now that are part of the Church of the Living God in Pakistan. And we're honored this morning to have Brother and Sister Hanscom. And they have come now in their ministry of healing and miracles to bring to us what God has brought to pass in their life. And they've got some books out in the vestibule that you will enjoy reading. Some of those books are filled with miracles that they've seen in the last few years, as well as the miracles that happen in the countries of Pakistan, India, and Sri Lanka. And you will enjoy it. You are to pay them a visit after the service. I want us just together just to welcome both of them together one more time. You're our friends forever. We love you from my wife and I and all of our family and this great church. Back to Milford, the Lighthouse. God bless.
Praise the Lord, y'all. You may be seated. And I love that song today when we said hallelujah. Can we say hallelujah again? Hallelujah. I just felt like heaven came down in this place. It came down here today. And I'm so glad I'm here to celebrate Jesus and to celebrate with you all. And I also want to celebrate with my dear friends, Brother and Sister Andrus, and this family have been such a blessing to us through the years. And when we're using the word forever, I'm thinking that's what we are, forever friends. And it means so much. And as I look around this beautiful church, I've been here maybe one other time since you had it finished. And I'm thinking, you know, this is the work of your hands. And you've done a great job. I'm telling you, this is a fabulous place. And I know God feels very welcome here and reaching out and touching the community. Well, we did have a great experience in Pakistan with the Andruses. That was really wonderful. It bonded us together forever, and they knew what we were all about in Pakistan, and we know what they're all about right here, all working for the kingdom of God. It's so wonderful. And the children and Brother Joel, now we have the pastor. He was just a little boy. I won't tell all details, but all of the girls, I mean, just feel so close. But Pakistan, does anybody know where Pakistan is? It's on the other side of the world. And many times we're asked the question, why would you take your small family and go over to Pakistan? You know, it's 10,000 miles away. It's far, far away. It's very hot in Pakistan. It's not a tourist destination. It's not like Mexico. It's a long ways away. It could be dangerous. And there are plenty of negatives why you might not want to go to Pakistan. I'll take that. But there is some beautiful, if you like history, there's a lot of beautiful history there. And the people are just really, really wonderful. But the reason we went to Pakistan is stated in Mark 16:15. And it's a small word that Jesus said, go. Like, what can't you understand about that small word? Go. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. And it all happened in the name of Jesus. We did it all in the name of Jesus. So because Jesus said go, we went to Pakistan. Now, I'm not going to let all of you folks off of the hook and said, well, when Jesus said go, he meant Pakistan. No, he meant Milford. He meant right here. He meant with your community. Go to your community. Go to your friends. Go to the people that you know. Let your light shine and invite them here where they can meet God like you. We're not selfish people. We want them to come and feel the same thing that we felt here this morning. And I'm telling you, it was so wonderful, so beautiful to have God come in and touch your heart again. And so we went to Pakistan because Jesus said go. And we went because he also gave us a promise. He said, I will never leave you, never forsake you. And of course, we know he never does. He never does that. But when we landed in Pakistan, it was like we stepped into the continuing book of Acts. Because Pakistani Christians didn't know about the Holy Ghost. They didn't know about water baptism. Excuse me. They didn't know about the oneness of God, but they were so hungry. They had been reading the scripture, and they said, oh, we haven't heard this before. And they came to the missionaries and said, explain this to me. And so they were very hungry for the truth. And if you ever wondered what a missionary preaches on the foreign field, well, this is it. It's Acts 2:38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I just quoted that, but that is the most powerful gospel that we have to present to this world. Very easy to understand, and it works in every language. It works among all people. It works every time. It's no hit and miss. It's for everyone. And it was so beautiful. The Pakistani people simply believed and they obeyed and they received this powerful gospel of Jesus Christ. And we were witnesses to that. How privileged we were to be there. We witnessed thousands of people receiving the Holy Ghost. And one little incident I would tell you about the word hallelujah. You know, it's the same in every language. We say hallelujah in Pakistan. So if you want to say hallelujah in Urdu, it's hallelujah. It's the same in every language. And I remember being in a village, and my husband had preached, and then we were praying for people to receive the Holy Ghost. And I noticed just a few tears come down their cheeks. And she's saying, we explained to her, repent. But then she started saying, hallelujah, hallelujah. Little tears running down her cheeks. And in that instant, God filled her with the Holy Ghost. Just so easy and so precious. Just like he comes. You know, he's never going to embarrass you. He's not. He's a gentleman. And just gently filled that little Pakistani sister with the Holy Ghost. So we've seen thousands receive the Holy Ghost in big crusades and in the village. And we've seen baptized people, so many people be baptized. One time I watched my husband, he was baptizing people in a dirty canal. Now, I'm not talking a swimming pool, okay? I'm talking about dirty, dirty water. And that's where the buffaloes go during the day. So he's down in this water, and he baptized 100 people that day in Jesus' name in the dirty water. It's not about the dirty water. It's about the name of Jesus. And it works every time. And we witness God performing miracles in the villages. The people are so needy. They're so poor and so needy. And God met all of them right there in their village. It's just amazing. It's not, he just doesn't come here, you know. God is everywhere. He goes to those little villages in Pakistan, the little lady sitting on the floor, and he touches them right there. It's so beautiful. I would tell you one story that is in the book. The book is called Miracle, and that we've written. And it's a story that when we were first there as missionaries, very soon, just a few months, and we had a big crusade. And there were lots of people come. They said, I think 8,000 people had come into that building. It was in a big tent. and they call the tent Shamiana, and they just keep adding on to keep the sun off the people because it gets very, very hot. You couldn't have a crusade without having a tent to protect the people, most of the people on the floor, but there were a few chairs that had been rented. And the people were just pushing and shoving to get up front to have somebody touch them in Jesus' name. They were desperate. Desperate people. And so I usually sit on the front row, but I noticed it was really crowded and things were moving. So I came and stood right beside my husband on the platform. And I'm so glad I did. As I was watching these people just, they didn't line up, you know, and patiently wait for the next person like we would. They were desperate. They were determined. They were going to get down here and get prayed for in Jesus' name. And received their miracles. At the end of that meeting, they showed us in the corner there were sticks and crutches and wheelchairs that the people had left behind because they had received a miracle in that crusade. But I noticed in the back that there was some commotion going on, and we were always worried about crowd control. And so I thought, I'm going to just keep my eye. I see what's happening back there. And there was a young couple with a baby, and I guess they realized there was no way they were going to get down to the altar with their baby. And in desperation, they wrapped the baby, bundled the baby up real tight in a blanket, and they started to pass it out over the heads of the people. So when it came to the next row, they just gently, gently passed it on to the next people until the baby came right down here in front of the pulpit. And so I'm thinking, Lord, I want to see what's going on here. Of course, I love babies. And I kind of just stepped over there. I said, Lord, what does this baby need? I don't know, but you know. And as I got close to the baby, I noticed its eyes were darting back and forth. So I knew maybe it was blind or had a disconnection in the brain. I didn't know the full story, of course. But I watched that baby's eyes just darting back and forth. And I remember, all I could remember is hands. I know the hands reached out and touched that baby in Jesus' name. And the next time I looked, those eyes stopped right in the normal place that it was supposed to be. It was a miraculous touch of God on that baby that day. In that instant, he touched baby and healed that baby right before my eyes. Do you think that makes me happy? God did a miracle for that baby in Pakistan. And so I was just watching carefully as that baby was passed out to the parents. And I thought, Lord, I would really like to know what happened here. I'm not going to get back there and hold that baby like I wanted to. But I was like, God, I wish I could know the whole story. And as that baby was passed gently back to its parents, and the parents looked into the face of that baby, and they kind of just threw it up, not real high, you know, but it was a hug. It was an exciting, exciting hug. And that was a sign to me that they recognized God had done a great miracle in their baby's life that day. I thank God for that wonderful miracle. And God is a God of miracles. He doesn't change, and God is no respecter of persons. And as much as I love babies, I know God loves babies and he touches babies, but he doesn't love that baby more than he loves you. Can you accept his love today? Yeah, isn't it wonderful? Jesus loves me. Oh, I am so glad that he loves me. And I believe you can receive a miracle today as you prepare your heart. And whatever you have need of from God, he is a miracle working God, and you can receive your miracle today.
Shall we stand together? Oh, I love that worship. Come on, clap your hands some more. Give the Lord the praise. I praise your name. I glorify your name. Hallelujah. We've already welcomed Jesus into the service, and he is here. I am not a miracle worker. I cannot perform miracles. I do not have a miracle in my pocket. But the miracle worker is in town, and he's here, and his name is Jesus. If you need a miracle today, today is a day for you to receive your miracle. Not because I'm here, but because He is here. He is the only one that is able to give to you your miracle today. We're so happy to be here and to greet all of you. And we love the wonderful Andrus clan, all right? Family. Wonderful, wonderful. Praise God. I'm so glad that God brought our paths together, and we've enjoyed so many years of wonderful friendship and fellowship. Mark chapter 10 and verse 27, Jesus said, "With men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible." Mark 11 verse 24, "What things soever you desire when you pray, believe that ye receive them." Believe that ye shall receive them, and ye shall have them. Even before you see it happen, even before you feel it, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. Hebrews 11, 6, "But without faith it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him." Romans chapter 10 and verse 8, "The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart." That is the word of faith. That's what we preach, the word of faith. The powerful word of God is so powerful. Romans 10 verse 8, the NIV version puts it this way: "The word is near you, it is in your mouth and in your heart." That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. It is with your heart that you believe, it is with your mouth that you profess your faith. The powerful word of God. The word of God, I believe, is the basis of every healing. It is the basis of every miracle. Psalms 107:20 says, "He sent His word and healed them." I want you to take your Bible, and I want you to place it on your body wherever you feel you need a miracle. If you need a physical healing, take your Bible. It's powerful. It's the Word of God. Just last week we were in Maryland. The pastor was having serious back issues, back problems, and he testified that when he laid his Bible on his back, immediately he was healed. I believe that can happen here this morning. Amen. In the name of Jesus. So have faith in God. Have faith in God. Nothing is impossible to those that believe. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We must understand that we are under the authority of the word of God. Lift your hands together right now and give God some praise. Thank you for the powerful word of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your word. God, you've given us the authority to speak your word. And we speak it this morning with faith. In Jesus' name, we claim miracles. Clap your hands unto the Lord, and you may be seated. I have come into the service this morning with high expectation. We have come in a state of anticipation. I believe that God is going to work a great work in our midst today. I have come in an effort to
help you exercise your faith. Exercise your faith. You know what happens when we don't exercise physically, right? I don't like to exercise. I find excuses not to exercise. But the Bible teaches us that we must exercise our faith. If we're going to see answers to our prayers, if we're going to see miracles in our life, we must learn to exercise our faith. The devil will tell you that you don't have any faith, but he is a liar. He lies all the time. That's all he does is lie. He's lying to you. He's telling you that you don't have faith, but you have faith, my friend. You have faith. The Bible says you have faith. Given to every man is a measure of faith. So what we are going to do this morning, we are going to move into the operation of God's power. Praise God. By exercising our faith. And these signs shall follow the believer. I am not the one doing the healing, but I pray for every person. And when I pray, I believe it's going to happen. It is going to happen, we believe, with faith in our heart. Praise God. So as we exercise our faith becomes bigger and bigger and bigger until we can believe God to do what His Word says He will do. By His stripes, I am healed. That means I am healed. The Word of God declares it. A few weeks ago, I was ministering in Missouri, and there was a young boy in the service that was autistic, and prayer was made for him in the name of Jesus. The very next day, Monday morning, his mother put this message directly out on Facebook. Since Sunday, Ethan has said new words, phrases that I've not heard before. He's able to follow instruction and transition to different tasks. This is a huge breakthrough for our family. This is the mother's report. I was preaching in Jacksonville, North Carolina. There was a man there that had cancer. He had a growth on the back of his leg. It was 16 inches long. He had spots in his lungs and on his liver. Prayer was made for him in that service in the name of Jesus. Mike went back to the doctor the next week, and when he went to the doctor, they discovered they could not find one single cancer cell in his body. He had been healed of cancer. Praise God. Praise God. And I could give you so many experiences and examples. I have pages of reports. In San Diego, I was preaching there. There was a little boy. His lung was collapsed. Prayer was made in Jesus' name, and God healed the little boy of a collapsed lung. In the same service, there was a man that had high blood sugar. His blood sugar had gone up over 480. He's sitting in the service. He's thinking, should I stay? Should I go to the hospital? Or should I stay and get prayed for? He stayed. He went through the prayer line. When he went into the prayer line, his blood sugar was over 400. When he came out of that prayer line, immediately it had dropped to 82. I'm telling you what God is doing. Now I want to declare to you here this morning, I have had people ask me, why does God do all these miracles overseas and we seldom see them here? I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. That is a lie from hell. The devil is lying to us. Miracles happen in the United States. Miracles happen in Delaware, in Milford, Delaware. And miracles are happening in the service this morning. In Buena Park, California, there was a man. He was paralyzed on his right side for 3 years. He could not open his hands or close his hands. But we prayed for him in the name of Jesus, and God healed him immediately of paralysis and filled him with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Our pastor's son in Merced, California, was having seizures. He had a seizure in the service. We were there. We prayed for him in Jesus' name. The pastor reported he has never had another seizure since that service. This is what God is doing in 2024. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I was preaching the conference in Tokyo, Japan, a few months ago. I had preached that conference three different times. 7 years ago, I was there. In the conference this year, after one of the services, there was a lady that came up to the front, and she had a young girl with her. And she began to tell me the story. She said, "Brother Hanscom, you were here 7 years ago. My little girl was dying with stage 4 cancer. We prayed in the name of Jesus for that child. And God healed that little girl of stage 4 cancer. And she was standing right there with her mother." There was a pastor in that service that had serious heart problems, heart condition. He had suffered for many years with his heart condition. I got a text message from him following the conference, a long text message, and he was giving God praise. He said, "God has healed me of that heart condition in that conference." Many of you know Brother Gordon Mallory. Brother Mallory is a very dear friend and great missionary, great man of God. He has been struggling for 5 years with bladder cancer. Finally, the doctor said, "We're going to have to remove your bladder." So he got prayed for there, I believe at the church in Mississippi. And he went to the doctor, went to the hospital there in Jackson, Mississippi for surgery. They said, "We're going to scope you one more time before we do the surgery." They scoped him. And they came out, the doctor came out and said, "Sir, we don't understand, but you have a brand new bladder. There is not one cancer cell in your bladder." If you could put the first picture that I sent to you up on the screen, there it is. This is Sister Drost, our missionary in Mexico. She happens to be my niece. I believe she was here years ago with her parents as missionaries. Sister Danita, a few months ago, had blood clots. She had a stroke. She had 3 blood clots in her brain. She also had aneurysms. The doctor, I talked to him, he said, "I counted 32 aneurysms, and then I just quit counting." I saw the MRI. Her brain, her head was absolutely full of blood. The doctor gave her less than 5% chance of survival. Really, the doctor told me there's no hope at all, but that's what they told the family. My wife and I got on a plane in Dallas, Texas, and we flew into Mexico City, and we spent 3 days with her there at the hospital. While we were there, we prayed, we fasted, we sang songs, we read scripture, we had church. And while we were having church, suddenly she opened her eyes and she looked around and she began to recognize the people in the room. Praise God. The second day we were there, she said, "Get me a chair. I want to get out of this bed." She wouldn't even let us help her. She got out by herself and sat in the chair. If you could put the little video up, there it is. 2 weeks later. 2 weeks later. That's a miracle right there. Our God is great. But we must believe God's word, and we must be willing to act on His word. If God says it, then it is true. God does not lie. If God said, "By His stripes I am healed," that means I am healed. If God has promised to supply all my needs, then He will. God always acts accordingly. God watches over his word, the scripture says, to perform it. Faith says, I have it now. Faith says, it is mine. Our faith must rest entirely on thus saith the word of God. So faith means that we believe that God has already done what we ask him to do. That is faith. Now let me add to that by saying this. Even before we see it happen, and even before we feel it, if you have to see it to believe it, that is not faith. If you have to feel it to believe it, that is not faith. When you get prayed for, we're going to pray. I want to pray for everybody in this room today. Every person, we want to pray for you in the name of Jesus today. And we are believing that you are going to receive your miracle. Now, when you walk out of this prayer line this morning, you lift your hands and you begin to worship God. You say, I'm not sure if I got my miracle or not. That is the enemy telling you that. You need to lift your hands and by faith in the word of God, you claim your miracle. You begin to thank him for it. Even before you see it and even before you feel it, you begin to thank him and give him praise. And the miracle will come. So my message today to you is this. I am a miracle, and you are a miracle. Now in the Bible, there are many miracles recorded. But the Bible also speaks about gifts, the fact that God gives to us good gifts. I believe that if we receive a gift from God, that is a miracle. That is a miracle. When we speak about the gift of the Holy Ghost, I believe that the gift of the Holy Ghost is the greatest miracle of all. There is no greater miracle than God putting his spirit inside of a human being. That is the greatest miracle of all. So turn to your neighbor and say, I am a miracle. And you are a miracle. Romans chapter 5 speaks about the gift of grace. Forgiveness is by grace. We have access into God's grace through faith. And the grace of God does everything for us. We receive remission of our sins when we're baptized in Jesus' name, by the grace of God. We receive healing by the grace of God. We receive our material needs provided by the grace of God. We receive our prayers answered by the grace of God. We have protection by the grace of God. We receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost by his grace. The Bible says that salvation is by grace. What does that mean? That means that we do not merit it. It means that we do not work for it. It means that we cannot receive it just because of who we are. Faith is the hand that reaches in and grabs a hold of that which has already been provided by the grace of God. God has already provided it. The price has been paid. I say the price has been paid. Just reach your hand in by faith and say, I want it. I claim it in Jesus' name. God has already paid the price. He has already provided it by his grace. Sometimes we think, if we get the right preacher, or if we get the right evangelist to come by, maybe I might receive my miracle. I thank God for great men of God that God uses, but I want to declare to you today that I believe it is your faith that brings the miracle. It is your faith. You must believe. And we need to realize that there's nothing wrong with the faith that God has given to us. We have been given a measure of faith. The word of God is in our mouth. So we speak the word. We speak the word. Sickness cannot stand against the power there is in the name of Jesus. Chains and bondage and addictions cannot stand against the power there is in the name of Jesus. Fear of COVID-19. Depression. Oppression. Anxiety cannot stand against the power there is in the name of Jesus. We speak his name. We speak his word. Deliverance from demon powers. Now, don't try to convince me that all demons are over in Pakistan, all right? There's a few demons in Delaware. There's a few right here in Milford. And I'm not talking about demon possession. We saw a lot of that on the mission field. I think the devil over here, he deals with us in a different way. He harasses the people of God. He brings fear. He brings anxiety. What is it that wakes you up in the middle of the night and you're afraid and your heart is pounding and you've got anxiety? I believe it is demonic activity that is tormenting the people of God. But I have come to Lighthouse this morning, and I declare unto this church that there is no demon anywhere. There is no devil that is so great that it can stand against the name of Jesus Christ. You can get up in the middle of the night and you can begin to rebuke the demonic activity that is tormenting you and destroying your family. I believe God wants to save our children. I believe God wants to bring prodigals back. Many times it is a demonic activity that is tormenting people and tearing families apart. But there's victory. There's hope. There's victory in the name of Jesus. Call on his name. Rebuke the demonic activity in the name of Jesus. And demons have to flee. Let's go to Pakistan for just a few minutes. So many miracles we witnessed. My wife and I, we were standing one day in our church in Lahore. And it was through the week, I believe it was Tuesday. And I noticed a big black limousine pulled up in front of our church. And I'm thinking, who is this? This is somebody important. And so I went to the door of the church, and there was a man that got out of this vehicle, and he had a uniform on. And I found out that he was a very high-ranking military man in Pakistan. He was carrying a little girl in his arms, and he brought her to the door of the church. Now, he's a Muslim. And he said to me, "Sir, I have heard that you pray for people here in Jesus' name that they get healed. Is that true?" I said, "Sir, it is true. It happens all the time. We believe there's power in the name of Jesus to heal." He said, "Would you pray for my little girl? She's got polio. She cannot walk." My wife and I stood in the door of the church, and we laid hands on that precious little baby, and we began to pray in the name of Jesus. He left. But 2 weeks later, he came back. And this time, instead of carrying his little girl in his arms, he's got her by the hand and she's walking along. Hallelujah. That's our God. I have seen Muslims healed. I've seen Hindus healed. I've seen Buddhists healed. God is going to honor faith wherever he finds it. I have to be careful with what I say here about our church in Pakistan. But years ago, I went up to the northern part of Pakistan, very close to the border with Afghanistan. And this is almost totally a non-Christian area. And we began, God had spoken to us through tongues and interpretation and told us to go to this place. And I did not want to go. I was afraid to go. But God said, don't be afraid. I will go with you. I will stand by your side. I have people in that city that will be called by my name. And so we went. I'll never forget the first night of that crusade. About 350 people had gathered there. And there was a man that jumped up, and he began to shout at me and threaten my life. I did not know what to do. You know, when you don't know what to do, you pray, right? So I just began to pray, silently begin to pray. And I felt the hand of God upon my head. And I was shaking, I was trembling all over. I didn't know what was happening. And it was there that I heard God's voice. In 60 years of ministry, I believe it's the only time that I ever heard the audible voice of God. But God said, pray for the sick. I will perform many miracles, and I will reveal myself to these people. So I made the announcement, is there anybody sick? And so everybody raised their hand because they're all sick, okay? I said, if you will come down here and allow me to pray for you in the name of my God, Jesus, you will be healed. Everything went quiet. And after a few minutes, a couple of young boys got a hold of an elderly lady that was blind. And they began to lead her down to where I stood. I remember as I reached out and I put my hand on top of her head. She was trembling all over. She was blind. And I said, in the name of Jesus, heal these blind eyes. And when I said that, that little lady began to jump up and down and scream. And she said, I can see. I can see. When this happened, all 350 people jumped up and come running down to the front and got a hold of the little lady, and they said, woman, what happened? She said, I don't know what happened. All I know is I came here, I could not see, but now I can see. God is my witness. Within about 10 minutes, we had witnessed three blinded people instantly healed, one right after the other. But that's not the greatest miracle. The greatest miracle is that God raised up a church in that city. It is a great church. It is a strong church. It's still a strong church today. In fact, that church has started many other churches all along the border with Afghanistan. It's an apostolic church. And now we have a Bible school there in that city. I'm telling you, if God can raise up a church in a place like that, he can raise up a church anywhere. Anywhere. I was preaching a crusade in Quetta. Quetta is in Balochistan province. It's very close to the border with Iran. I had gone there several times. I had preached in that city. We did not have a church, so when you don't have a church, you just preach on the street, okay? So I had preached there several times on the street. But now I was invited to come back to Quetta and to preach in the large Methodist church. And so I went there and we began to preach a crusade. And we had many, many people get the Holy Ghost. But the second night of that crusade, there was a Muslim man that came to me. And he said, sir, I have traveled 600 miles to see you. I heard that you were here. He said, a few weeks ago, you prayed for my little girl out on the street. She had cerebral palsy. He said, I've traveled 600 miles to thank you for praying for my little girl, because now she is 100% well. She is completely well. I'm telling you what Jesus is able to do. There is no healing in these hands that they can heal, but there's power in the name of Jesus. And I could go on and on, and if you can get a chance to buy the book out there called Miracle, there's more than 20 different outstanding, notable miracles mentioned in that book. But in closing this morning, just before we pray, I want to tell you about a great miracle that happened to my wife and I and our family. If you could put the next picture up on the screen. This is my son. He was 5 years old. I was at the church. We were in the middle of a conference, and I was actually standing in the pulpit teaching when there was a man that rushed into the building and said, your little boy has fallen off the roof of your house, and he's in very serious condition. I remember I ran out of that room, and I got in my van, and I rushed to the emergency room of that local hospital. When I ran into the emergency room, there was my little boy, 5 years old, my only son, and he's gasping for breath. By now, his head is twice the normal size. The doctor that was there, I knew him personally. He called me by name. He said, Don, I have to tell you, this is hopeless. This is hopeless. He said, we don't have the equipment. We have no way to treat him. He said, he's got massive brain injury. He commenced to tell me that his brain was literally coming out through his left ear. He said, that's really a good thing because it's relieving pressure. I remember here we are in Lahore, Pakistan, in a very remote area of the world, 1975. There was no email and there was no cell phone. I tried for 3 days to get a call through to the U.S. I could not get a call through. Nothing would work. But God knew exactly where we were at. Exactly. My wife and I, we prayed for 3 days. For the most of those 3 days and nights, we took turns holding our son in our arms and praying and crying out to God for mercy. But on the third day after the accident, all was gone. There was no breath and there was no pulse. My wife ran out of the room screaming and saying, I can't stand to watch my boy die. I remember as I reached down, I believe that he had already passed. And I grabbed him and I pulled him into my arms. And I held him so tight. And I fell down on my knees in that hospital ward. And I began to scream, Jesus, Jesus. I know you can heal my boy because I've seen you open blinded eyes and I've watched you to make crippled people walk. And I know you can heal my boy. It's my turn, God. I need a miracle. I need it now, Jesus. And when I prayed that prayer, suddenly I began to feel somebody tapping me on my left shoulder. And I turned around, and there was a man that was standing right beside me. I did not know him. He looked like a Pakistani. He was dressed as a Pakistan man would dress. He did not give me his name. He didn't tell me where he come from. All he said was this, God has sent me. That's all he said. He reached his hand out and touched my little boy in the forehead. And when he did, my son immediately opened his eyes. Immediately. Daddy, I'm sorry I climbed up on the roof. That was the first thing that he said. I began to give praise unto God. My wife came running into the room because she could hear him talking and laughing. There was about 100 people standing around, most of them non-Christian. Most of them had never seen anybody pray like this before. I stood up and I turned around. I wanted to get acquainted with this gentleman. I'm thinking in my mind, he's a pastor. I didn't know who it was. But when I turned to get acquainted with him, he was no longer there. I don't know who that gentleman was. I ran out of the room and I went down into the parking lot. And I searched the lobby area and I kept looking. Where is this man? I want to meet him. I want to talk to him. I want to get acquainted with him and thank him for coming. But I could not find him. To this day, I've never seen him again. If you'll go to the next picture, that's him. That's him. Got three sons. This is a miracle right here. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost working in this place right now. I believe that miracles are taking place even right now as we speak. I feel faith rising up in this room. There's an expectation right now. I don't know if that man that showed up and touched my son, if he's here this morning, he could be here. I believe it was an angel that God sent down all the way from glory. There's angels in this room right now, I feel. And I believe that whatever you need right now from God, you can receive it. So today, we speak faith. We proclaim healing. We speak miracles. We loose miracles in this room. My friend, it doesn't matter what the doctor said. The Word of God declares, I am healed. I am healed. So we proclaim what the Word says. We are not going to beg God for miracles. We are children of God. You are a child of God. No, God knows who you. God knows what you need, and He loves you, and He's reaching for you right now. We're going to have a prayer line, what I call an old-fashioned prayer line. Better term for that is miracle line, all right? Because today, miracles. Pastor, I believe that there will be testimony after testimony after testimony of people that receive miracles in this service. Lift your hands together right now. Come on. Jesus is here. He didn't come riding in here on a donkey this morning, but He was here. Even before we got here, He was here. He's been waiting for you. It's your turn to receive your miracle. Let's stand together. I've asked the pastor to arrange this. Here's what we want you to do. You say, you've got to pray for everybody. Yes, I want to pray for everybody. I want to pray for every child. I want to pray for every young person. And this is not going to take a long time, all right? I was in San Francisco recently on Sunday morning, and we prayed for over 1,000 people in that service. We actually had two services, 1,000 people. So today, it's not going to take a long time. Here's how this works. We have this prayer line here, and some of the elders and leaders and whoever the pastor has chosen this morning, just come and stand right here in the front, if you will. And thank God we have some ladies with us as well. Okay. The pastor says we want you to come from the right side. That means all of you over here, just move over this way, all right? And you're going to come through here. Now, here's the thing. Do not stop. You don't have to hurry, but don't stop. Just take your time. But as you move through, because we got to keep the line moving so that everybody will have an opportunity. But I believe that as you go in over here, the pastor is here, and the bishop, and they're going to lay hands on you. But you keep moving. Raise your hand. Keep moving. Keep moving like this. And as you walk through, all these wonderful people of God are going to reach their hand out, and they're going to lay it on top of your head, and they're going to say, in Jesus' name, receive your miracle. In Jesus' name, receive your miracle. In Jesus' name, receive your miracle. When you come out on this side, all right? Is everybody listening? When you come out from this side, you lift your hand and you begin to glorify God and you begin to thank Him. Thank you for my miracle. Thank you for what you've done for me. You say, I don't know if I got my miracle. That's where faith comes in. You claim it according to the word. According to the word of God, you claim your miracle. And I believe that as you go your way, the miracle is going to come. I'm going to speak a word of faith. Pastor says, just move her to the wall on this side, my right, your left, and just come down that aisle. All right. Where Sister Andrews is standing right there, the line is starting right there, okay? So just come. We have time for this, folks. And we want all of our visitors that are visiting today, we want you to come also. We want you to feel absolutely welcome to come. Lift your hands together right now. Just stop moving for a moment. By the power and by the authority of the Word of God. By the power and the authority of the name of Jesus. Receive your miracle. Come on. Come on. In Jesus' name. Just keep the line moving, if you will.